Alright, so we have something a little bit different for you here today. Have you ever argued the merit or reasoning behind the rise of each of Japan's three great unifiers? Was there any particular one that you have ever questioned, perhaps even simply wondered if their role in the grand scheme of history was entirely necessary? Or even if you think maybe there was someone better suited for the job of unification, in terms of not only uniting the land, but also ensuring that it remained that way? Well, that is exactly what we are going to be doing here today, but I won't be doing all of this arguing alone. Rather, here I want to welcome another great content creator here on YouTube, Japan at War. It is here he and I will take turns arguing in favor or against the three great samurai leaders who brought Japan out of the warring era that was the Sengoku Jidai and unified the country under a single regime. Starting on my channel for sort of the first half and then heading over to his channel for sort of the second half, which he will upload by Friday. This is by no means our actual thoughts and feelings towards these figures, but rather a playful debate. I know for a fact there are figures here I will be arguing in favor of and against that I actually feel different about in all truth, but this is the nature of the game. So, with that said, let's start things off with our first of Japan's great unifiers, Oda Nobunaga.
So a lot of people point out how violent Oda Nobunaga was, but they often don't think of him as a tolerant man. And yet he was. Well, at least as far as religion goes. He was also quite forward-thinking, but I'll touch on that in a bit. When most militarized cultures, and I think it's fair to say that Japan was, are approached with a new religion that contrasts with their native religions, it's pretty common for them to be indifferent towards them, and even hostile. Which is why Nobunaga's reaction towards Christianity was so incredible. When he held real power, he used it to protect the Jesuit missionaries, whom he viewed as incredibly brave for traveling as far as they did for their beliefs. This protection extended to allowing them to build places of worship, which is honestly a pretty big deal considering it meant going against the big religions in the country, namely Buddhism. And I'm sure you're all well aware that the monks held incredible power. He also hosted debates between the Christian missionaries and Buddhist monks. Now, think about that. Foreigners with a foreign religion being allowed to make their case against the monks of his country with his native religions on an even playing field. Race didn't seem to matter, except the merit of their argument. Well, to be fair, Nobunaga did want to take the monks down a notch, especially because they did have political power. But he was also genuine when he said that Christianity had merit in its teachings, and that that alone was enough for him to not only tolerate them, but even encourage their work. He even told them to visit him often so that they could discuss said teachings. He especially became fond of the Jesuit Louis Fra, who famously wrote History of Japan. I also mentioned him as forward-thinking. I mean, this man revolutionized the way that war was fought in Japan. Now sure, matchlock guns and gunpowdered weapons predate Oda Nobunaga's rule. And sure, he wasn't the first to use these weapons, but never was there quite the same focus on them as it was within Nobunaga's armies. He also made sure to focus on his foot soldiers, as he correctly estimated that the real strength was with the common soldier and not the samurai. By the way, this included promotion within the ranks as well. I mean, just think of Toyotomi Hideyoshi. Ability mattered just as much, actually often even more so than just birth, which made his army's leadership incredibly strong. Religion and military, though, wasn't his only contributions. He standardized the roads in his provinces and put an emphasis on having newer roads built, which doesn't seem like much, but it actually was. This made it easier for civilians and merchants to travel. What he also did was implement Raikuchi Rakuza, which got rid of most of the monopolies on trade and eliminated a lot of the guilds that put limits on said trade. All of this was done with the idea that this could stimulate the economy. And it worked. I think it'd be incredibly hard to argue against Nobunaga's rule. Yeah, he had his downsides, but he definitely made up for them.
Nobunaga was a major influence. It is impossible to throw all of his accomplishments out the window and say he wasn't one of the most significant figures in Japanese history. As I have said before, I am a firm believer that Japan needed someone like him to get the ball rolling on unification. But it is really just that I wish to counter with the idea of unification. Nobunaga was obviously the first of the great unifiers, but let's examine if he was really the best man for the job in the first place. Prior to Nobunaga's march on Kyoto, the Ashikaga Shogunate had lost virtually all of its authority. What was left was really just the luster of what came with the name of the Bakufu, let alone all of the culture and political intrigue that laid within the imperial capital. This had led to many powerful clans abusing said influence to sort of run the show. Clans such as the Hosokawa, Ochi, Miyoshi, and Rokkaku are just to say a few. And it is important to remember that although these families were strong, none of them were looking towards unification by any means. They were all ambitious, working to grow their own clout. One of the biggest misconceptions about the period was that every daimyo was out to become the next shogun, when in actuality, most daimyo were just after regional influence. This then brings us to Nobunaga, who kicked in the door, marched on Kyoto, ousted the puppet masters who had been trying to run the show in the capital, and set up his own regime by installing the exiled shogun Ashikaga Yoshiaki to his proper seat of power. It's clear Nobunaga's ambition was to unite the land under his control and reforge it for the better. But as we know, he was not perfect. Nobunaga wanted to rule Japan, and he took the most cutthroat approach to this, sparing none in pursuit of his ultimate dream. And through this, we can also see his power-hungry nature. Installing Ashikaga Yoshiaki to be the next shogun was simply a facade of legitimacy for Nobunaga, giving him free rein to war with all those who opposed him in the name of unity under the shogun and a semblance of a central government. It was too late when Yoshiaki finally realized this and began calling out for help in ridding the capital from the tyranny of the Oda, eventually leading to Nobunaga's dismantling of the shogunate altogether. Nobunaga would not suffer anyone who dared to stand in his way. When betrayed by the Azai, he engaged in a brutal warpath against his own brother-in-law. When facing off against the Takeda, he utilized brutal new tactics to crush their army into the dirt. When the son of one of his top allies, Tokugawa Ieyasu, was rumored to have a hint of rebellious intent, he forced Ieyasu to order the death of his own son. And most abhorrently was his infamous massacre he committed against the civilians and monks of Mount Hiei when he sent his army up to burn down the historic temple and slaughter all in their path, all because they had sided with his enemy. Nobunaga's actions are known to have caused a lot of dissent within his own clan, and are largely blamed to be the cause of his death at the hands of one of his top commanders, Akechi Mitsuhide, who Nobunaga had continually humiliated and ridiculed for the past decade. For sure, Nobunaga did get a lot done while he was alive, pursuing his grand dream of a unified land under his sword. But I think it is important here to pose the argument that he was not the best man for the job, but rather the man who he stole the initial idea from was indeed the more qualified candidate, this being Imagawa Yoshimoto. Yoshimoto is someone who does not get nearly enough credit as he should, as instead he gets relegated to being remembered as the buffoon who was caught off guard and defeated at Okehazama by Nobunaga. In reality, Yoshimoto was a very competent governor who had a deep understanding of Kyoto politics. He himself understood his own strengths and weaknesses and fully understood he was not qualified to be a military leader. He just did not have it in him. This was something that he had come to grips with, likely years earlier when he was part of the Imagawa Civil War that saw him installed to power. He was not a good military commander, but he was surrounded by others who were. He knew who had talent and used his skilled commanders to win his wars. His defeat at Okehazama should not be seen as any fault of Yoshimoto's or his commanders, but rather the sheer spontaneity of Nobunaga. With the great power Yoshimoto commanded and his great aptitude for administration, I feel he would have easily been a fantastic unifier if he had the chance. Yoshimoto would have been a competent visionary who could have been the staple of power in the capital, ensuring new stability and putting the right samurai leaders in the right places so that they could excel. Japan could have just as easily been unified by Yoshimoto, and I think it is completely safe to bet that he would have never suffered the same fate that Nobunaga did at Honnoji. However, that is a completely different reality that we will never know. Nobunaga did win at Okehazama and he did kick off unification. Although his untimely death in 1582 would pave the way to his successor, Hashiba Hideyoshi, who we will get to next.
And that is where I will come in, because I am for Hideyoshi. First off, can we just acknowledge something? Hideyoshi's rise to power could only be described as inspiring. The man started off as a peasant foot soldier and rose all the way to Taiko, ruling all of Japan, finishing what Oda Nobunaga started. And that's something worth mentioning. He not only held all the regions that Nobunaga had conquered, but also took the rest of Japan, not always through combat, but with diplomacy, which is pretty important. Ravaging through Japan costs money, material, and lives. Actually, we should probably step back and talk about his success under the command of Oda Nobunaga. In 1558, he became an ashiguru, or foot soldier, for the Oda clan. They weren't that powerful yet either. Very soon after that, he became one of his sandal bearers and just continued up the ranks. But how? Well, the man was an expert negotiator. If there was a force that he or Lord Oda could not easily conquer, he would do his best to talk to the enemy's men and get them to switch allegiance, which is incredibly risky. There was always the chance that the enemy could lay a trap and just kill him, or just lie and put Oda's armies at risk. And yet this didn't really happen. Why? Is it because he was just lucky? Perhaps. But I believe it's because Hideyoshi was a pretty shrewd guy, and more importantly, Nobunaga thought this as well, or he wouldn't have promoted him so many times. Another reason I am for Hideyoshi's rule was the fact that he avenged his lord's death. As we all know, Akichi Mitsuhide betrayed Oda Nobunaga, and while this happened, Hideyoshi was actually engaged with the Mori. And when Hideyoshi heard about this, he was able to make a quick peace with the Mori and race back to kill Mitsuhide, which he did in just 13 days. Now, Tokugawa Ieyasu also tried to avenge Nobunaga's death, but he just wasn't fast enough. When it came to who would succeed Nobunaga as head of Clan Oda, Hideyoshi's pick, Oda Hidenobu, prevailed over Ieyasu's pick, Oda Nobukatsu. Hideyoshi and Ieyasu engaged in several conflicts, but in the end, Ieyasu sued for peace, leaving Hideyoshi the winner. Now, all this means for me that the natural successor to Nobunaga's path towards unity was Hideyoshi. Also because, I know it's going to come up, yes, the Imjin War was technically a failure, but really not as much as everyone thinks. First, the plan to conquer Korea was actually very sound. They did almost push the king out of Korea, and had the sea routes been clear, which was part of the plan, they would have held ground in the first part of the war a lot longer. By the way, if you want to see what I mean, you should check out my in-depth playlist on my channel. Anyways, the benefits of the invasion was it kept the many daimyo so busy that they would have a hard time plunging the country into civil war again. Now, as far as repercussions go, I mean, well, apart from Toyotomi clan losing a bunch of money, well, there really wasn't any. And the last thing that I will mention that makes me pro Hideyoshi was that he did a nationwide census. This measured just how many people lived in what areas, how large the different domains were, and how fertile the regions were, crop expectations, and what reasonable taxation should look like. This was super important to a stable economy and was actually something that, well, we actually do in some form today.
While it's harder to pinpoint who, if anyone, could have replaced Oda Nobunaga as the first of Japan's great unifiers, I feel that the answer is much easier regarding Hashiba, later Toyotomi, Hideyoshi. But before I talk about all of the possible alternatives, we first need to discuss why he may have not been the best choice from the very start. Like Nobunaga, Hideyoshi was a very unorthodox figure. In many instances, he has often been considered one of the most innovative samurai commanders there ever lived, which can be seen very easily in the many battles and sieges he fought in. But his unique demeanor also coincides with what history remembers to be somewhat of wild card behavior. Hideyoshi was not born a samurai, but instead was low born and had to crawl his way to the top. Luckily for him, he had a commanding officer who respected this sort of out-of-the-box ingenuity that Hideyoshi brought to the table. But that does not mean that he was all around a well-liked figure, or that his actions never tread into the realm of delusion. And ultimately, it is important to recognize that even though he did end up unifying Japan by 1590, a mere 8 years after the death of Nobunaga, much of his success can be argued in large part due to the position he adopted at the head of the former Oda central regime. It is miraculous, though, that Hideyoshi was able to succeed even with so many obstacles around him, and that he was able to cement himself atop the country in a position where he could continue to reforge it into a more stable society. Still, though, he was not successful enough to make himself the final unifier, as in the end, his failures would pave the way to an inevitable third. This obviously then begs the question, who would have been a better unifier than Toyotomi Hideyoshi, who not only could have faced fewer obstacles in taking leadership of the Oda regime, but also would have been able to bring a swift end to the wars and unify the land while establishing a strong enough government and legacy that there would have been no need for a third unifier? Well, in my opinion, there are three possible answers, the first of which being a rather obvious one. Tokugawa Ieyasu, the man who would later become the third great unifier. Ieyasu was one of the strongest Oda clan allies and an easy contender to take up the mantle of leadership after the death of Nobunaga. Hypothetically, if Ieyasu would have been able to defeat the traitor Akechi Mitsuhide before Hideyoshi got the chance, Ieyasu would have become Nobunaga's true successor. Someone who could have attended the Kyosu conference with true power behind his words and began to stir influence in his own direction, thus making it possible for him to assume total control within a number of years. This may have even led to him establishing his shogunate much earlier. Additionally, there is the scenario of him potentially defeating Hideyoshi during the Komaki Nagakute conflict, but by that point I feel Hideyoshi's regime was a bit too entrenched, and a full takeover from that point would have been much too strenuous. Ieyasu makes for a solid alternative because he comes fresh with everything needed to lead the nation. Competence both politically and militarily, and a name most recognized, with lineage that he had skillfully connected back to the prestigious Minamoto family, along with children who could inherit his position upon his death. The second alternative could perhaps be Oda Nobutaka via Shibata Katsuie. I do not believe Katsuie would be one to want power for himself, but rather ensure that power stayed within the Oda family. This can sort of be seen in his intent at the Kyosu conference following Hideyoshi's victory at Yamazaki. Katsuie favored Nobunaga's son Nobutaka and wished to see the family headed by him instead of a puppet figure like Hideyoshi wanted. This would later lead to the Battle of Shizukatake. Let's say, hypothetically, that Katsuie was able to crush Hideyoshi's armies here in 1583, guaranteeing that the Oda family remained prominent under a figure like Nobutaka. Now, was Nobutaka a great leader who could have unified the land? It is questionable. While it appears he was beginning to show some real aptitude for leadership, it is hard to say how competent he was in terms of clan politics. Although he would have had the great benefit of being surrounded by those loyal to him who were much more skilled. Figures like Katsuie, Maeda Toshiie, and many more who would have no doubt worked tirelessly to continue the Oda clan's ambitions, which by this point already sat in a powerful state. There's no telling what the future could have held for Nobutaka, but he may have certainly had a smoother ride to the top than Hideyoshi. Now, the last alternative is by far the hardest to gauge, but it is still 100% worth mentioning. This is the man who betrayed Nobunaga himself, Akechi Mitsuhide. Hypothetically, let us say that Mitsuhide defeated Hideyoshi at the Battle of Yamazaki, cementing his leadership and rallying more allies to his side. His road would have still been incredibly hard, as he would have still likely had to contend with figures like Katsuie and Ieyasu, who no doubt would have leapt at their own chance to avenge Nobunaga. But that is not to say that he still might have come out on top. Mitsuhide, who had self-proclaimed himself the new shogun after the death of Nobunaga, had continued to call upon his would-be allies. Clans like the Hosokawa and Tsutsui may have very well fell in line with him, as well as the Chosokabe of Kyushu, who Mitsuhide had worked hard with diplomatically in the past. Yet, there is one major factor that could have given Mitsuhide an upper hand in future threats. Mitsuhide having slain Nobunaga and considered the Oda clan's top enemy could have called upon clans already hostile to the Oda to aid the new shogun in his quest to bring peace to the nation. Now, this is understandably a very wild scenario, but with powerful clans like the Mori and Uesugi having been at war with the Oda, there is a sliver of a chance that they may have signed on to aid the Akechi. Would this have ever worked? Who knows, but I think it's still fun to think about. Either way, these three alternative options that I have proposed get placed into a new light when we factor in Hideyoshi's failed invasion of Korea, known as the Imjin War. Would these alternatives still have set their sights on the mainland just like Hideyoshi did? This is a question we will cover in part 2 of this video on Japan at War's channel, which you will upload by Friday. There, we will first finish the debate regarding Hideyoshi, focusing on his own reasoning and rationale behind the invasion, before I argue what the other alternatives I posed might have done. But following this, then, we will move on to discuss the final of Japan's three great unifiers, Tokugawa Ieyasu, and whether or not he was truly right to take power, or perhaps he was indeed a false unifier. And with that said, thank you for watching, and don't forget to like, subscribe, and ring the notification bell if you enjoyed this video and found it to be most interesting.